2017 regular session. Everybody's had a chance to review them. Corrections have been made.
They're not.
Did you got last email you got?
Yeah, I'm here. His name's included.
The name you put in?
Right here. See, you go here, the name's right here. But you go here, the name.
No, that was in your folder the first time. I brought him in the night.
You did?
Here.
This one.
So anyway, make a motion to accept the meeting, so. January 4th meeting.
Second. Got a motion and a second to accept the minutes of January 4th meeting. Any further discussion? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries. Citizens' inputs. You're hearing a lot.
Sorry, I didn't get it.
That's all right.
Jeez.
None heard. Moving on. Mark Umball, Marshall County Economic Development Corporation report.
First of all, we got County Development for the Future, February 16th. So I don't know if you can make, any of the members can make that at Swan Lake. If you can, let me know.
What time is it?
11:31.
They have handicap parking.
I should be walking good by the way.
Okay, under marketing, three proposals were submitted. There were zero site tours for the industrial park. And Jerry had done some work with WNIT on economic outlook. Product development, there were meetings with Joe Hunting and Cody Brooks with IAB and First Bank to line up any potential financing if indeed we get to the point that we get a shell building up. Also, we're looking at another option, but that option is right now confidential. Colonial Estates, there was a couple of calls made with Colonial Estates, and there's been an agreement made, so you guys are pretty good to go on that one then. Upcoming utility meetings, we're currently meeting with Jamie, Majority Builders.
We did that today.
That is true today.
Yes.
Marketing video, we received MCEDC received $1,000 from the town of Argus, and Empathy $2,000, so the video, the Argus video is over for. And interestingly enough, on Inside Edge, which I think you went down to Indy on that thing, Suzanne, sorry. Argus's segment has been the most watched video in the state of Indiana. That was sort of interesting to find out. On the comprehensive plan, I want to thank George, Dustin, Suzanne for being at the meetings on the comprehensive plan with the steering committee. As you well know, we've made a lot of progress on that. It's moving along great, and I think it's going to be a super comprehensive plan by the time it's done. County Development for the Future, I just gave the invitations on that, so let me know if and when you can make that, or you can call Pam, by the way. And internal communications, we've had, he had a meeting with the Argus executive, we had an executive meeting with Argus counsel, and then report given, he gave the report on January 4th because I could not. So, any questions? Thank you.
Thank you, Mark. Moving on, Chris Van Dyne.
Yes. Three things, and none of three of them will take that long. The first one, I talked to Corey for a hot minute about, my wife and I would like to donate some police teddy bears to the police department, if that's all right. Something that Corey could give away whenever he comes across a case where there's been some kind of domestic violence or something where a child has witnessed something, basically for Corey to use at his discretion. Just something that they could have in their cars to do with as they please. We donate them, no cost to anyone. And when I asked Corey, he seemed that it was okay as long as it didn't get in the way of his duties. As a,
no problem at all whatsoever.
So I was just wondering if that was okay, if I should go ahead and order. Is there any objection to any of
that? No objections for me. No objections.
Appreciate that. That's the first one. That's quick. Second one. There's this book called Mapping Manhattan. And what this author did was they went ahead and they gave 10,000 people a blank map of the island. And what they asked them to do was go ahead and draw the island as you perceive it yourself. You know, some people went through and picked out the neighborhoods. Some people went through and said, oh, I lived here, I lived here, I lived here. Some people went through and they view Manhattan as their first relationship. And they talked about, oh, I had my first wife with my date here, drew an X, oh, then we had our second date here. We got married here, we bought a house here, you know, whatever the case may be. So I was talking about this project with Kurt Nellens over at the school board. And he seemed to think that it was an okay idea. He'd take it to the school board about possibly sending a whole bunch of maps of Argus to have teachers use them in the school, let kids draw their own. Some of them might draw, you know, their route to school. Some people might, you know, draw whatever they do. Some people may just color it. I don't know. But they were also going to give some to take home to their parents to have them do it. And I was coming here today to ask if you would be willing to do the same and try and reach out to maybe the older community that doesn't have connections with the school. And what we'd like to do is we'd like to take them, we'd like to just kind of select 100 or 200 people that actually took it seriously and bind them into a book, kind of just another idea showing people's perceptions of what Argus is and what it's like to live here. I think it could be good both for historical purposes. My wife and I have agreed to pay for binding about 100 of them, so we're not looking to sell them or anything. It's not something to make money on. It's just something to kind of cash or some history. But I was wondering if you guys wouldn't mind figuring out a way to reach out or even, I don't know, talking to the newspaper about it or however all that stuff works. I don't really know.
Hear that, Jim?
What?
All right, well, that's all that was. But yeah, you know, I'll just leave these with you guys and look through them at your will and see if it's something you guys want to talk about or not. It's up to you guys. And then lastly, I also came today, there's somebody who wanted to help start another business, and they asked about an Airbnb policy. And some people, and if Argus has one, some people might not know what Airbnb is. It's kind of like hotels.com. Airbnb is an app that's on your phone that allows you to rent out part of your house or your space, basically. And sometimes towns frown on Airbnb because if you have a local hotel industry, it might take away from their business. So some towns have policies. One town I know is discussing a policy right now, Carmel. And that's because if you go to Carmel, you have to spend about $120 to stay in a hotel room. So a lot of people in town who have spare bedrooms are renting their spare bedrooms for $75 a night, and it's kind of hurting the local hotel industry. Since Argus doesn't have a hotel industry, I assume that there's not going to be an Airbnb policy for a few years, but I kind of wanted to reach out and just touch base before actually seriously talking to this person about if they want to open a business.
I know nothing about it.
Do you want me to send you some information? And I can't come back next time, but, you know, just send you, maybe email something to Lisa or...
I've used it. It's kind of neat. I mean, they want to, I could rent my room out, but for the people that did, I was glad they did.
Sure, yeah.
And it's really cool, too, because it's not just about, like, a cold kind of hotel experience. You actually meet the people in the house, too, so, yeah.
But anyway, I thought it was a nice idea. If you do actually have any intention of setting up a policy, please let me know before we get too far down the road. I don't like, you know, promising people things or helping people do things, and then they suddenly fall apart or get upset. The youngins get hurt. I'll go ahead and send you some information about Airbnb, if that's okay. Maybe you can add it to them.
Yep.
All right. Fine. Thanks for the time, Chris. Be happy here.
Thanks, Chris.
How long are you on for?
I'm here till Friday. But hey, if you want to hang out.
Yes.
Only 2 days, huh?
Yeah, well, no, we got here. Yeah, we got here Sunday, and we've been meeting all the time.
Okay.
Thanks again.
Thank you, guys.
Have a good year, everybody.
All right. Old business. Attorney report.
Two things. First, we did get back to the farm lease. Bill Boris is on vacation, which is why he hadn't responded to me. I've got three originals here that really are set up for the signature of Dustin, and I have Lisa attest. The second, the signature page is not, you can read it, but it's, I think it's a scanned, signed, back to me copy, so it's not the greatest, but you can, like I said, you can read it. So, one original for me, one for your records in here in the town, and then I'm going to get one of those back to Bill, and then we're going to go for another year on that. The other thing I have to go over and tell you about is a situation with Itamco and a couple pieces of real estate. And I think there's, everybody can take one of these, and there's one too many. Well, did Julie have a packet down there?
Well, we're kind of packing stuff.
Building one. Fill that in her packet. Jim, I think you're aware of what is going on as well, but just so correct me if I say anything that's out of line or incorrect, but back in the 80s, I think it was, this electric substation was kind of constructed out there near the Itamco property. It's right along the roadway there. Come to find out, through some of Itamco's doings, that Argus does not own the real estate where that electric substation is sitting.
Or current.
Right. Where it's currently sitting, but Argus does own a piece of real estate in the middle of Itamco's parking lot. Now, how that ever got to be, I'm not real clear, and I don't know that it really makes a lot of difference at this point, other than the intention was, back again in the mid to late 80s, that Itamco and Argus were going to swap these parcels of real estate, which obviously makes sense, so that the town would own the real estate that their substation sits on, and that Itamco would own the entirety of the parking lot. I've talked with Gary Neidig. I've really talked a lot with Jamie Lindstrom here in utilities, and we're trying to get put together an arrangement to be able to swap those parcels of land. And I think Jamie may have had conversations with at least some of you folks here on the council. So this isn't a total surprise to you, but I'm coming to you tonight because I think this thing is going to fall into place relatively quickly. They were having survey work done to be able to create a legal description of the parcel, and you can see on the map, it's the one down there on the south end. It's the rectangle that says 0.354 acres. That is what the town will receive in exchange for deeding away the parcel up in the upper right-hand corner that says 0.6743 acres. It's going to be an even exchange of real estate. No money's going to change hands. We're envisioning a closing at Metropolitan Title. That's who Itamco wanted to use as a closing agent. It is going to be an insured transaction, which basically means that there'll be at least some insurance policy. It may not be significant, but there's going to be something there that basically a warranty that we're getting good title to this real estate, and the same for our Itamco. The biggest thing about that is it's going to do a judgment and lien search so that, again, we know that we're getting property free of any judgments, no liens. And this is something that shouldn't happen 20, 30 years ago. The mechanism for the town to be able to do this in terms of, if you remember, you know, it's kind of particular how we can do things with real estate. We are able to do an exchange of this real estate, but what we have to do is have a resolution. We also have to have a public hearing. I've got things set up. I've got the notice prepared to have a public hearing at our next meeting on February 1. It would be at 7:15. And I also have a resolution, a draft of that prepared that basically authorizes the town to go ahead with closing on this exchange of real estate with Itamco. I want your blessing to go ahead and I've talked to the pilot and told him, I hope I have the authority to be able to run this thing, and she's already got a spot kind of reserved for us to have this in the paper before the 21st is our magic day to have it published by. She's good with that, so all I need is your blessing to say, yep, go ahead and get that notice around, and so we can have our public hearing, do the resolution, and then proceed with the closing at some point as soon as Itamco gets a survey back.
I make that motion.
I'll second it. A motion is second to allow Derek to go ahead and publish everything it needs published.
Yeah, we'll deal with that resolution at the next meeting after the public hearing.
Right.
To have the council approve that, assuming that you do.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
And that's what we'll do. That's all I have.
Thank you, Derek.
I move to accept the attorney's report.
Second.
Got a motion and a second to accept the attorney report. All in favor say aye.
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 Motion carries. Board openings, Marshall County Tourism, Planning Commission, and BZA.
Cemetery?
Everyone's supposed to be off here.
Software.
I'm thinking about what you said last meeting, so. Was it you?
No, no, it was Mark.
Sorry. Wrong Mark. I'm thinking about what you said at the last meeting. Ways to reach out.
And whether you're going to say you're now on all three of them.
Any other old business? All right, new business. B&R building, rental amount, and nonprofits. Everybody has the forms. I'm going to correct that. You got it. Was you going to say something?
Yeah. On the total in red on your paper, you have to take $12,000 or $1,200 off of that for rental space for the trustee. I forgot to take that off. So we do have income that comes in on rental space for the trustee. So that would adjust that down just a little bit lower. But that would be then your total loss for the year. And if anybody wants to look, I have the original.
That's $175 for the rental and $100 refundable between the deposits.
I think we first need to ask, what is the purpose of the B&R building? What is our purpose in having it? Are we trying to provide a space for nonprofits? Is that our intent? Are we trying to cover costs with rentals? Do we have a clearly defined idea of what we want?
It was just, it was pretty much, as long as I've been on a break even, hopefully. And we never wanted, it wasn't profitable, never has been profitable. I didn't think Mark was back on there, both Marks.
No, this is a community center. I mean, normally you're going to take a hit. You're not going to have something that's going to make you money.
However, on the other end of that, I don't think that rate's been raised in quite a while either. It's been the same amount for quite some time.
I was going to say it was 50 or something like that, wasn't much.
You have the original ordinance in front of Dustin. It was raised in 2008.
Yes.
50 to 75?
They're a little on the old ones.
See, Real Services uses it, Girl Scout Troop 399, Girl Scout Troop 73, Argus Youth League, MC Homemakers, and the Lions Club uses it. Plus the trustee, of course. That's the only one we're under right now.
Yeah, I was going to say, wait a minute, that's what we're doing now.
Yeah, that's what we're under right now.
Am I correct, we're going to have some major expenses in this? Is it that on a five-year plan?
Yeah, we're going to have to, there's some structural issues that need to be taken care of on the building.
I was thinking $1,000 or something coming up here. Am I, do you know Jim Hoffman?
Well, there's tech weight that needs to be done. There's some also some brickwork in the front that has shifted that needs to be done. There are some things that we could do on the utility side to, that furnace is old. I don't remember the last time that it's old. And maybe if we upgrade that, cut down some, put a higher efficiency in, higher sear air. I mean, those are all things that could be done to cut down on costs, but you're going to have capital outlay. Another thing we could do is change the bulbs to LED. That should cut your energy way down. Install a different thermostat that can't be monkeyed with. That maybe we could control here wirelessly or whatever to see what, so we can monitor where that thermostat is set exactly. So those are things that we could do, but there again, I don't do the budget for the BNR, so I don't know what you have budgeted as far as maintenance goes or for capital outlay for the project. So.
And on these expenses, they're not broken down, so we don't know how much is, you know, it's being spent for heat or lights. These are just total expenses. So this is fun.
I was told to just put it on a piece of paper like this for you, so I apologize.
Excuse me.
Our town bills are highlighted.
So this is BNR?
Mm-hmm.
Highlighted.
No, they're all BNR. But the highlighted ones are town bills.
Utilities.
There's not a total of just the utilities, but there is a total on the front sheet. And then I took out the BNR deposits that we refunded. That gave me a lower number, and then the number that you see in red after.
Before the 1200.
Right. The number in red was before the $1,200 trustee payment, which I didn't realize that was in red.
For that, please.
When he handed you a check.
So
You told me to put it on one sheet of paper.
Expenses for.
Yeah, I just was looking.
On this contract with the Wheel Services, it looks like we provide eating utensils. I don't know who works with this.
I only does, Susan actually does this out for me. It has not been touched since 96. When it was signed, it went into effect in 97, so.
Does the town provide that for them? Are we using real or are we using disposables?
I don't think we're providing that.
I think that's all provided by Wheel Services.
Because in here it says we provide it.
The contract was for the oven use, but we've since replaced that oven.
Yeah, there's a letter.
The town bought it, so.
About the stove, and it says that we have to buy that stove from them if they ever decide to leave for $500. Well, in 2010, we bought the stove, so that needs to change. I talked to the lady at Real Services. She's all for redoing this contract, but she will not pay rent. They are a nonprofit, so. She would like the hours to stay the same, and if the town is still willing to provide that, then great. But I think that the Rail Services contract needs to be looked at and maybe revised. I just kind of brought that forward this time for review. I think a lot of this is outdated.
In one place they say 10 to 2, and another place, a couple other places, 9 to 1.
Yeah, and then, you know, we have them going in there early in the morning, putting the food in the oven, warming it up, you know, leaving, coming back. You know, I don't really have a problem with that. I'm just saying that it needs to be kind of written in there.
So I need to review that.
I think it's a good program. We have some seniors that do do it, so. And they deliver meals to the community, but I could be wrong.
They used to, I think, just.
They deliver meals to them, you say?
I'm not sure if they do, but they, you know.
How many people participate in this program, do we know?
I don't know.
I've been called up there 2 or 3 times on the ambulance, and 20, 25 people have been in there.
Really?
Not all of them at once, but.
It's a rough guess.
Kind of come in and.
Yeah, they come and go, but I mean, usually they'll sit and play cards or do puzzles and stuff like that.
Crafts.
And usually I've seen 20, 25 people in there.
I've went in there a few times, and it's usually pretty packed.
Yeah.
And it's a good benefit for our seniors. They get to get together and.
They look forward to it.
Something to do.
They do. They look forward to it because there's something to do.
We definitely need to revisit the contract.
Yeah, I'm just.
I don't have a problem with myself, the non-for-profits using it.
Do we have to vote on that?
We do over here, yeah. And then I would say you up the rental $100. Current rate would be one. You get what I'm saying?
I have that new ordinance.
Well, I haven't seen the new ordinance. I've seen the old. Well, this is the ordinance with the new rate at $100 for rental. And $100 deposit. I don't have a problem with that either. $100 isn't bad to rent something.
No, not for a building.
It's good warm bread and supper.
A kitchen, a kitchen.
No form of bread punch.
No.
Is that what this is, is it?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, that's probably why. I didn't think about serving.
Wedding.
Well, I could make them hyper too. Yeah, that's right. And then we need to revisit the contract for Rail Services. We need to get Derek in there. We need to know what changes we want out of it. We
date.
Well, yeah, but I mean, we're not gonna give them a stove.
No.
They'll buy the stove again, that has to be out of there, maybe we need to look at it and update it that way.
And be consistent on the time.
Yeah.
It's all over the place.
It's like, between 8 and 9, that the rail services delivers the food.
Oh, do they deliver? I wasn't sure if they.
They actually bring it and deliver it.
Here's, the one that she.
Is that next to coffee, does?
No, that's the one that's, if we pass it, it changes. Seeing the person in charge. That might change.
Well, the contract and the application are two separate things, aren't they?
Yes.
Yeah, I was just reading the application.
Since there's so many things in the contract.
So in the application, they changed their times.
Yeah.
I can definitely clean that contract up, it's really, when you look at it, really, there's not much there. I'm not saying that there needs to be a lot there either, but.
I guess we'd also probably need to get ahold of rail services and find out when they, you know, because like I said, you got times all over this thing, when they want the times.
Yeah, but they were
10 to 2, and.
9 to 1.
9 to 1, and.
First 9:30.
That's all. That's all.
Yeah, definitely get rid of the last page.
Like she said, we bought the.
Step one, I make a motion that we suspend the rules and pass ordinance 2017-2 on all three readings to raise the rent on the DNR building.
Second that motion.
Got a motion and a second to suspend rules and pass ordinance 2017-2 on all three readings. Any further discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries. So we took care of that, now we gotta figure out the contract. Derek goes through it, and then get a hold of, have all the rail services. Find out times.
Well, it seems like we're in contract.
Well, what I'm gonna do is get with Lisa or whoever from the town first, find out what we want to have in the contract, and then kind of scratch out a draft, but make sure then that, that meets what rail services needs and that they're okay with it too. But yeah, probably start with other ones.
Number two, I make a motion that we allow the rail services, Girl Scout Troop 00399, Girl Scout Troop 73, Artemis Youth League, MC Homemakers and Alliance Club to use the B&R building at no cost on the dates stated on their sheet for 2017.
Got a second?
A second.
Got a motion and a second to allow the, we'll just say the 2017 B&R nonprofit organizational usage sheet. Now it's got Real Services, Girl Scout Troop 399,
Girl Scout Troop 73, Argus Youth League, MC Homemakers, and Lions Club to use the table as non-for-profits. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Motion carries. Well, do we have anything that we need to, do we want to address in this contract right now? Derek's going to give it to Lisa, but do we have anything that we want to address specifically right now and say, Derek, do you want this changed? Besides, we want the last page taken off.
Yeah, we want that stove taken off.
Just taken.
I'm not going to talk anything about the stove.
All right, I just want to make sure that there was nothing that anybody wanted to, all right.
This says here the sites of 10 to 2, where did you guys see the other time?
On the application, they changed.
Oh, just keep going.
The contract says one time, the application, they changed it. See, it says generally it should be used between those hours, but on the application, they ask for those specific hours.
All right, moving on. Or would you want to move on yet?
Well, if you want to change the hours from 9 to 2, that covers both of them.
But I think they go in there earlier than 9, so I think that's something that we need to address with them.
Yeah.
I think they're going at like 7:30, putting the food in the ovens, you know what I mean?
Well, that's just one person that does that. He drives up in the truck and puts the food in, he takes the food in and locks the door.
And I guess, it sounds to me that, and this is, I guess, what we'll hash out, but maybe they have members of the community in the building from 9 to 1 or 9 to 2.
Right.
They may be people, employees from Real Services, maybe in hours that are a little different than that. We're okay with that, which it sounds like we are. We can include language in the contract that kind of permits that.
Moving on, ordinance 2017-1, the salary ordinance.
Sorry to bring this up again. Josh had received a raise in June according to his lineman's contract. I kind of highlighted it on the back for you. And so when I took the rates off the old ordinance, it did not reflect his raise. So he was actually, after we gave him his percentage, and he made less money than he should have. So I had to rewrite the ordinance with his change. The only change on there, isn't that?
I make a motion we suspend the rules and pass ordinance 2017-1 in all three readings.
Second.
And motion is second to suspend the rules and pass ordinance 2017-1 on all three readings. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries. Any other new business? Department head reports. Department.
You should have my report in the packet. I want to have a couple things, I guess. Just highlight our staff for the month of the year. This was last month, December 13th, criminal arrest, and 92 for the year. We had 29 traffic arrests, we had 364 for the year. Had 9 accidents last month, we had 53 for the year. 14 criminal investigations, that's 194 for the year. The only other thing I had to talk about today was police department started there, which is kind of looking forward to that. And I was going to ask about the charger, I think, last meeting. It was still in the factory, so that was a little over a week and a half ago, so hopefully we're getting close. The other thing, I didn't know, George, did you want to bring up the crossing guard issue?
All right, yeah.
I think I took care of it if you wanted to.
Remember we talked about
one of our crossing guards was sitting in her vehicle on the phone, and we made the decision to, we had to use the little shed, or how to, whatever you want to call it. And she approached me one day when it was real cold and was complaining and said she couldn't stay warm, and she didn't know why she could sit in her car, and on and on. I told her, my exact word was, "It doesn't matter to me, but we had complaints, that's why we changed the rule, you had to be in there." Somehow she took it as, "George says, you can do what you want." So Corey had to have words with her to straighten that out, but.
It was 3 degrees that day.
Yeah.
It was 31 degrees in the guard shack, that heater running, so I don't think that should be an issue. The only thing I would maybe suggest was, I've only seen, and she keeps bringing this up to me, there's only one kid in the morning that crosses the, I don't know if it's feasible to have the crossing guard at that intersection. I don't know if that's something you want to visit, or?
Only one kid?
Where's the rest?
Where are they?
Crossing in the morning. There might be a couple in the afternoon.
And maybe this time of year, but in other times there are.
I was gonna say, for all these years, I know there's been kids, there's kids that live down there, I'd just leave it alone and not worry about it.
Because about the time you take that out, somebody's gonna get hit, and I'm like, oh.
There's several, I've seen crunches.
Do what?
But Clement doesn't even offer shacks to their crossing guards.
No.
So.
And we moved it from where it was at.
Across the street there.
When we did move it, we put $600 in it to fix it. Then we moved it to that side so that she could look down and see that child coming. So I think we've.
Did the door get fixed or whatever?
The door is fixed.
That's the door's fixed.
Okay.
Everything's nice in there.
Okay.
Like I said, it was 3 degrees outside, it was 31 degrees inside. But.
Yeah. I think Corey took care of it. Just leave it alone.
Leave it alone.
Just goes to show you what happens.
Thanks, Corey.
Thanks, Corey.
Utilities. My report's in your packet. We're really enjoying this weather. We haven't had near the plow damage or anything like that, maintenance-wise. So the guys are getting caught up on vehicle maintenance that we had let slide due to some other things that we're doing on. The other highlight that I will tell you is I'm back to working 4 hours a day, Monday through Friday, and it's from 7 to 11. Workers' Comp has released me to do that. And then we had a visit from IOSHA in regards to our accident. He was here for about 2.5 hours. We were cited for three things. We didn't have our placards up in the break room. We didn't have time loss reports of a OSHA 300 and a 300A. I had no idea what he was talking about. Obviously, prior superintendents didn't know either because we had never kept those records. We are from this point forward. And then there was a possible railing on the truck that was involved in the accident of it not being 42 inches high. I told him we bought the truck in 2000 and that's the way it came. So I don't know how we could buy a truck that wasn't compliant. Platform-wise, it's supposed to be 42 inches square. It's 18. If we put it 42 inches square, I'm going to be beating down weeds on both sides of the road when we drive. So, I mean, there's just some common sense things there. With all that being said, we are cited, but we will not be fined because they cannot fine one government agency to another unless you are a union. If you are a union, then you can be fined. I also asked that question, had I died, could a fine been imposed then if a death carries something different than, and he said, no, it probably still wouldn't be fined. So we're just gonna come in and tell you what you gotta have and to my wife. It's not worth anything, I guess, I don't.
So you're saying, so they can't until you die tonight?
Right.
They can find all they want, collect it, it's not worth it.
So with that being said, I'm still waiting on their report to get back on things that we are required to have. We have since rectified, I'd say 3 out of the 4, and with the fourth one being the truck. If we have to arbitrate that, I'll have to take it to B&G Trucking or something and have the rail raised. There again, if we're not gonna get fined, I'm not gonna say anything. I'll just leave it at that. So, those are the highlights and lowlights of the month. I'm just glad to be here.
Thank you, Jim. Glad to have you back.
Fire.
Yeah, my report there. I think everything's running smoothly. We have added a few new people. We added one female that comes to us from Macy, and she's fully educated and all that she needs in the fire service. But she comes right on, and then we have one that's waiting for school, and then we put a trainee on last week, so which fills the roster, so we're looking good for now.
Along with that note, a handful of firemen started taking apart the building over there, the issue we were having, help the town guys out so they could get going on the drywall. And we had our party last weekend for our Christmas party. You want to call it year end party? I call it Christmas party. And somebody paid for it, donated for the departments. So.
Where we at on the turnout gear washer and stuff, Mark?
I think we're moving forward on the grant. I think everything's going good there. We're waiting on a company to come, and they want to do some measurement.
Right. And they did it Friday.
Did they come Friday?
They came Friday, yeah. Okay. I knew there was something else going on. They came Friday, did all the measurements. Last Friday.
Yeah.
All the measurements. They were going to go back and get quotes. Full installation.
Okay. All right, and that took care of EMS too, right?
That's Candy.
No.
That's Bob.
All right.
The only thing on EMS, I came to the meeting last night, and Richie told me that AccuMed has billed out quite a bit, and he said if they get half of what AccuMed has billed out, it'll be more money than they've ever got in. So AccuMed is doing a good job, and it looks like it's working. I guess people have learned how to use the program, and it's getting easier and easier for them. But he was pretty happy with it. It looks like there's a chance that there will finally be some money coming in. That's just what he told me last night. So.
Suzanne.
Wait a second. I want department head reports, so I'll accept them.
I didn't know we can do that. Got a motion?
Second.
Got a motion and a second to accept department head reports. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries. Next up, Suzanne Amal.
What I'm about to say will make some uncomfortable and may not win me many friends. And I apologize for that. But I'm not on this council to win friends. That's not why I was hired slash elected. I was hired to work for the people of this community and to keep this community a good place to live and to keep improving this community so it's still here in the future. With small communities today, this is a major challenge and it takes a great deal of work. There are still days I don't know which way Argus is going, up or down. I'm not sure. I do know we have a tremendous amount of work ahead of us to keep Argus on the map. We as council members have all been elected by this community, and we have elected our officers.
and they are the leaders of Argus. Anyone can conduct a meeting. Leaders need to be proactive, forming the tone, the vision, and the direction of the community. That's what leaders do. Some of us at this table only see each other twice a month at council meetings. I don't know what the rest of the council is doing, and they don't know what I'm doing. And you know, it's really tough to work together when we know nothing about each other or what projects we're working on for the town. Essentially, we're the board of directors for Argus, and our behavior should reflect this. So please, let's get past the pettiness, the gossip, and the half-baked opinions. We should be above that. George is very conscious of what our town employees are paid and if they're earning their pay, and rightly so. But are we earning our pay? We're paid $245.68 monthly to be on this council. If we only attend these meetings twice a month, that's $122.84 per meeting, or perhaps once a month. That's pretty good pay. As president, you know, Dustin makes more, which is reasonable. We are all liaisons to various departments and boards. Can we explain what is happening within that group? Are we bringing their concerns before the council? And you just did, thank you. Every month, our department heads give reports to the council. What I'm suggesting is council members do the same, that we give monthly reports to the community of our activities. And you, the community, need to be engaged in holding us accountable. You elected us to this position to do this job, and your taxes are paying us. Please hold every one of us up here accountable. Look forward to our monthly updates to know what we're doing. And I hope to hear from some of you the questions on what I'm doing. I would love to share some of the things I'm doing. So please hold us accountable, learn more of what we are doing, and let's learn more about each other. Thank you.
Well spoken. Thank you.
Thank you, Susan.
Claims.
Total docket for January the 18th was $167,376.31. Those claims were number 30 through number 93. The top five claims. The first one is for the town of Argus for $50,000. That is repayment of a loan. Second one was payroll number one for $31,148.10. Third was First Source Bank at $18,254.29. Fourth is Indiana Department of Revenue corporate tax at $10,251.39. Fifth is Town of Argus for the sewer transfer. It is $7,800. The total of all five claims is $117,453.78, which is totaled out to be 70% in the docket. We have not been billed from Anthem yet. When Anthem bills us the first time, it will be for 2 months, so be prepared on the next docket.
That should come out sometime next week, they said.
Yeah.
Accept claims 30 through 93.
A second. Got a motion and a second to accept claims 30 through 93. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Motion carries.
got anything else?
Did you want us to bring this up? This, well, we're gonna bring it up, how's that sound?
I don't know.
Lisa did some paperwork for us, on people that skipped out on utility bills for the town of Argus since 2006 to 2016. The town has lost $100,569.62 over a 10-year period of unpaid utility bills from people skipping out.
Small claims.
Yeah.
We do collect on some. Some are uncollectible.
Has it improved since we?
That is one thing that I was kind of asked at the last minute to work on, so I was gonna work on the 2015 to 2016. To see if it had improved.
Because we've changed our policies a little bit.
Right. And it probably has improved a little bit. I think it has. Yeah, you're not seeing thousands of dollars in the rear anymore. But I'm not sure if this is the way to fix it or if, you know.
We're always gonna have some loss because we bill a month and a half behind. Honestly, I don't know of any other way to do it. By the time you get your readings in, you've gotta have time to, you know, get everything entered and get billing going. So from the time we get readings in, it gives us 2 weeks to get everything in and billed. So then they basically have 28 days before disconnection would occur if they didn't pay it. So essentially, depending on when they would move in or whatever, they can be in there for 2.5 months before they'd ever be disconnected.
Do we have a percentage of these that might be rentals as opposed to owning?
Probably, yeah. I mean, that's something we can figure out. We have not done that yet.
Is it a high percentage offhand? Just
you mean of the outstanding bill?
Yes.
Yes.
The outstanding.
I would say probably yes.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah. Anywhere from 80 to 90, I would say yes.
That's what these people here took care of by making the property owners responsible for it. So if the people just leave, well, then it still gets paid. But something we may want to think about.
We hope it still gets paid. Got a little more to lose than us.
Yeah.
Improves the odds.
Improves the odds. There you go.
If you look at the ordinance that I included in your packet from another town,
yeah.
If you look on Section 4, since we went over water and sewer rates.
I do.
It should be like in the back, but on Section 4 and the very last, it says trip charge amount on there. So I just wanted to.
That was my concern with my guys. If we get a landlord that's crossways with the renter because they're not paying their rent, and then the landlord says, go shut them off. I want utilities on. Well, we need to have a way to recoup our trip charge to where that we're not getting in the middle of a tenant landlord dispute kind of thing, or the, you know, it's just somebody that they went out for whatever reason.
So when something like this is passed, and it's kind of, it's a law, so yeah.
And this is just one of like four or five towns that have started doing this.
Mm-hmm.
This is the only town that I found that had all the utilities that we have.
Okay.
So that's why I picked that one rather than this one that had water, sewer.
Right.
It's just something to think about.
Right.
but since we're gonna rewrite all the ordinances for water, sewer, and all of that, I think it's something we need to...
This would be the time.
Yeah.
Motion to adjourn.